Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. I am Dr. Compton Ross Jr., lead pastor of the Decatur Seventh-day Adventist Church, and we are absolutely delighted to welcome you to our virtual worship services at Decatur, where we say it's greater. We're so glad that you've chosen, in spite of all the technical difficulties that we've been having that has allowed us to be starting a little bit later than we usually do. But nonetheless, we're so glad that you've chosen, you've stuck with us, and you are here. And we know that God is going to bless you in a mighty, mighty way. I want to encourage you to go ahead right now and share this broadcast with your families and with your friends, because God is getting ready to do something special. I'm going to invite you to bow your heads with us, even as we pray at this time. God of glory, God of love, God of power, we give you praise and glory today that you have allowed us to connect with our family and friends. We pray right now, God, that you will bless this broadcast in a special way. Move in somebody's life. Have your way right now. We give you praise and honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Friends, just before we move to our next section in our worship today, I do wish to share with you some announcements and some news. We have a lot of exciting things happening at the Decatur Seventh-day Adventist Church. First of all, for those of you who are leaders here at Decatur, our board members, we have a special announcement for you. We need for you to connect today at 4 o'clock p.m. Please check your emails, your text messages. We've sent the word out so that you can connect today. It's a very important meeting as we are talking about reconnecting with each other. I do want to share with you, church family, that we're looking forward within the next couple of months or so to coming back to this place, to our physical church. And so this afternoon, leaders, we need to connect so that we can plan and we can organize how we are going to be reconnecting with each other. So we're looking forward to doing that very soon. We can see light at the end of the tunnel. Secondly, for leaders and those of you who are working with our community center, we want for you to know that we're also having a meeting at 1 o'clock on tomorrow. It is very important that you connect for that meeting as well. These meetings are so important. I wanted to make sure that we share them with you today. Talking about the Quest Center, Candler Road Economic and Social Transformation. As you know, this building is completed. We want you to know that 3 months to this day, the 10th of July, yes, save the date, July the 10th, we're looking at a ribbon cutting ceremony. That very weekend, July the 10th, the 11th. So we want you to save the date. It's going to be a special event. We have been looking forward to this time. Also, on next Sunday, April the 18th, at 7:30 in the morning. Yes, you heard it right. 7:30 in the morning. Well, some of us are just turning over in our beds at 7:30 in the morning. But friends, we need all of our able-bodied men to come and help us set up a tent right at the Deja School, the Decatur Adventist Junior Academy, 2584 Youngs Lane Road in Stone Mountain, Georgia. We're inviting you to come. Come with your sledgehammers. Come with your work gloves. Come prepared to have a good time working to set up this tent for our school. Also, we do want to mention and ask you to continue to keep in prayer various members of our church family. Please continue to lift up those who've lost loved ones recently. Sister Deborah Stevens, our prayers are with you, as well as Sister Vonda Hendrickson. Please remember these individuals in prayer. And then we do want to also celebrate some birthdays. We have, I believe, a couple of Sabbath birthdays. And my pad is just acting up right now, but I'm going to go by memory. We've got our brother Jarrett Roseboro, who is having a Sabbath birthday today. And then I believe also young Carter. I'm trying to remember his first name, but we will invite Pastor Darrell to share his name a little bit later on. But these two Sabbath birthdays we are having today, we want for you to celebrate them. Give them a call, and we truly want to say happy Sabbath birthday to you. God bless you. God keep you. And again, welcome to our services.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Mark 9:23 in the English Standard Version says, "And Jesus said to him, 'If you can, all things are possible for one who believes.'" We're praying. Heavenly Father, you are worthy of all of our praise. Holy is your name. Lord, throughout the difficulties in life, it's challenging sometimes to believe. So, Lord, help our unbelief. When doubt creeps in, when we are unsure of what's next, Lord, we ask you to remind us of the promises that you have in the Bible. Remind us of the covenants that you have established for us even today. Bless us as a church, Lord. Use us as vessels. We recognize that you are the potter and we are the clay, and the potter determines how the clay is formed and what the device is used for. Lord, there are many under the sound of my voice this morning who are sending up personal silent prayers, Lord. Give each one the attention that it needs. And Lord, specifically, we want to remember Sister Deborah Stevens, the Donwell family, and Vonda Hendrickson and the loss of loved ones. And we pray specifically for Eric Donwell today, who's experiencing some health challenges, but Lord, you are a healer. Bless the message that is presented today, Lord, through all the challenges and difficulties we've had in getting set up here today, Lord. We know that through the power of your Holy Spirit, that your word will still come through because there is someone out there who needs to hear directly from you today. Finally, Lord, bind us together as a church in the love of Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. And now is the time for us to participate in our church service by giving. Usually we pass around plates, but we're not able to do that during the pandemic. So there are three ways that you can give. You can go online to www.decatursdachurch.org/give, and you can give there. The second way that you can give is to go to your Cash App on your phone or your device and put in the handle $DSDAGive, DSDAGIVE, and you can give there. And finally, if you want to do it the old-fashioned way, you can mail a check to Decatur SDA Church, P.O. Box 372032, Decatur, Georgia 30037. May God continue to richly reward you, and may God continue to bless you. Thank you. I lift my hands in total praise to you. Thank you so much, everybody, for tuning in. Do me a favor, share this broadcast with everybody in your circle of influence. And just before we begin, Tavari Carter, salute to you, man. Happy birthday. Praise God for you. And Jared Maestro, it was already said happy birthday, but I want to personally say it again to you, man. Thank you so much for your contributions. Thank you so much for how you have excelled and exceeded in music and taking this thing to another level. We salute you, my brother. Let's jump right into the word of God today. Noah. Last time I preached on Noah and coming out of the boat and coming out of the ark. You know, it was 1 year later. Right now, we're going to hear the other side of the story. Pray with me. I don't deserve the love you've shown. The blood you shed covers my wrong. Beyond my faults, O Lord, you've seen and said you'd still use even me. Oh, Lord, I tried to do my best. Although sometimes I do much less. You called my name and I ran away, but you still called me another day. Yes, even me, Lord, even me. Though scarred and broken and unworthy, my guilty stains, you washed them clean and said you'd still use even me. God, sometimes I fall and make mistakes, but brand new mercies I show. You show me every day. You are my strength when I get weak. And out of the darkness, you lifted me. Yes, even me, Lord, even me, though scarred and broken and unworthy, my guilty stains, you washed them clean and said you'd still use even me.
Thank you, God, for using us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Genesis chapter 6, verse number 8 says, "But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord." But the key text that I want to give you today is Genesis chapter 9, verses 20 through 23. Bible says, "Noah began to be a man of the soil and planted a vineyard. He drank of the wine and became drunk and got naked in his tent. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father and told his two brothers outside. Then Shem and Japheth took a garment, laid it on the backs of their shoulders, walked backward and covered the nakedness of their father. Their faces were turned backward and they did not see their father's nakedness." Noah, the other side of the story. Noah and his family were in the boat in the ark for more than a year, tossing and turning with the waves from the flood, water coming down from heaven. All of the water in the earth below gushed forth and caused Noah and his family to be in this crazy place for more than a year. My wife is a travel agent, and we love going on cruises multiple times a year, if at all possible. Royal Caribbean is her specialty, although she can book anywhere. And we love cruising. That's just our preferred way to travel. And I love being on the ship. You know what? 7 days is now too short for me, right? I like to do a 10, a 14 day if I could. The 14 days are a little crazy because you still have to, you know, debark, but they put you in a little holding spot, give you some breakfast, and then you can go back to your room. But you can do the Eastern and the Western Caribbean. You have people waiting on you hand and foot, right? I love Royal Caribbean. You can eat at the Windjammer. You got like 10, 12 different restaurants. Johnny Rockets is on board, right? You can go and get, you know, hot dog if you like that sort of thing. They got ice cream, y'all, by the pool that literally comes out of the wall, frozen yogurt. Come on, somebody, can you just type Froyo in the chat if you like frozen yogurt? I love that thing. You can go to Sorrento's Pizza. Go to Sorrento's, you can get a slice of pizza at any given moment, at any given time of the day. Right across from Sorrento's, they got like this big car, right? Model car in the middle of the ship. You go right across, you can get some desserts if that's what, you know, tickles your fancy, right? You got fancy restaurants, you got Mexican restaurants, you got pizza, you got hot dogs, right? I personally, no disrespect to anybody, but if it's not a balcony cabin or if it's not a suite, I just can't do it. I can't do it. My preferred is the 14th floor on any of the Royal Caribbean ships. I love the 14th because you got the kids zone. I could drop my son off, but then, you know, we can go to the solarium. The solarium is a cool spot. It's an adults only place. You go there for breakfast. You know what I'm saying? They give you the egg whites and the tomatoes and, right, you feel like you're eating healthy in the midst of all that other food that you got. Right. You can go on the other side of the solarium and you can just look out over the water and eat your breakfast and relax. And it is so enjoyable. I love cruising. But can you imagine this ship, this boat, this ark? Noah and his family are on the boat, not being waited on hand and foot, actually having to wait on each other, actually having to wait on the animals. Can you imagine all of that feces that's on the ship? See, on the cruise ships, you know, people go and they eat all sorts of stuff and drink all sorts of stuff. And yeah, they call it Montezuma's revenge, right? They got to go to the bathroom, right? And we may not be privy to all of that funk and foul stuff, right? And then it collects in the ship. And what the cruise liner does is while we're in the ocean, they just let it out in the water. But there weren't any fancy pumps and running water. Here was Noah and his family literally had to not only deal with their own mess, they had to deal with the mess of the animals and taking all of their stuff and throwing it out of a little tiny porthole to keep the ark clean. I don't know about you, but that's not my idea of a vacation. Even though I love, I can deal with the 7 day, I can even do a 14. And I promise you, once COVID is over, I'm taking a 14 day. You know what I'm saying? But a year is just a bit too much to be on the water. So Noah and his family were on this ship, on this boat for a year. But praise God, it was finally time to exit. And if you read Genesis chapter 9, as they were exiting the ark, Noah, his sons, their wives, and Noah's wife, they received
a specific set of commands as well as a promise from God. The command was to be fruitful, multiply, and have dominion. They also received the promise of a rainbow. That's right. They received a promise of a rainbow. I see you, Sister Wedgeland. You say, I can't imagine being in a situation like that for that young. I see you, Katina. You shouting out the frozen yogurt. Hallelujah. Noah and his family get a command, and the command is to be fruitful, to multiply, and have dominion. Then it gets a promise. The promise is from God saying, I'm going to put my rainbow in the sky so that, yes, it will rain. Now you all are accustomed to rain. That was the first time it had ever rained to water the earth. The water came from underground springs, right? And Jesus is saying, guess what? It will rain, but I will never flood the earth again. What that says to you and I, ladies and gentlemen, is that God is the God of second chances, because he told Noah the same thing he told Adam and Eve: be fruitful, multiply, and have dominion. Aren't you glad you serve the God of a second chance? Aren't you glad that you serve a God that will not cancel you? We got cancel culture today. He says, even though you messed up and even though I had to deal with that, there was some consequences, because watch this, the forgiveness of our sins does not automatically equate to the nullification of the consequences of our sin. Yes, we may have done it. Yes, we may have gotten our hand tapped a little bit, but God says, I still love you, just like a loving father, just like a loving mother. You have to discipline your child, right, from time to time. And I'm not saying abuse. Come on, if you're abusing your child, I will call defects on you first. You see what I'm saying? But there's a difference between abuse and discipline. And sometimes as children, we need to provide discipline. And God gives us discipline, but God says, I'm going to give you another chance. I'm still going to love you. And God says, I'm going to give you the same command I gave to Adam: be fruitful, multiply, and have dominion. Meaning, watch this, even in the middle of your second chance, your purpose is still valid. Your gift is still valid. God didn't take away his call on your life. So even though you may have messed up, you are still gifted. You are still called. You are still loved. You are still chosen. There ain't a thing you can do to separate yourself from the love of God and from the thing that God has called you to do. Can somebody just get excited right now over the fact that even though the world may cancel you, God says, I still love you. I still chose you, and I still have a purpose to accomplish in your life. The Old Testament, people believe that God was a God of wrath and the God of vengeance. But how many of you know there's just as much grace in the Old Testament as there is in the New Testament? How is that possible? I'm glad you asked, because God is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. His love for us will not wane. We are his children, and he loves us no matter what. I see you, Alexa, saying hallelujah. See you, Wesley, saying amen. I shout right there with you, hallelujah and amen. Because for those of you who are in ministry, whether you preach, whether you sing, whether you're a leader, right, you got to be a little bit crazy or a little bit called, probably both, to be in a position of leadership. I stand before you as your pastor telling you I mess up all the time. I make mistakes all the time. And while people want to turn their back on your boy because he messes up, I'm so glad I serve a God that will never turn his back on me. And before I go any further in my message, let me encourage somebody who's thinking you've lost your opportunity. Maybe you've missed your window. You settled for, as Anthony Brown says, a temporary thrill, and God no longer loves you. Or even worse, maybe you believe in this Western version of Christianity where you say you have to be good and do good all the time. And if you're not, God is going to get you. God specializes in multiple chances. He is not that God where you have to work your way into the kingdom, where you have to always make sure you're on point. Otherwise, he's going to let you go and let you fall. Or worse, he's going to kill you. God ain't that type of God. He's a loving God. He's a merciful God. And he is not this big bad wolf. He loves you. You didn't miss your chance. You didn't miss your opportunity. There is more in front of you than there is behind you. Keep going. The best is yet to come. God's promises in this story, it tells us that we still have a chance to be fruitful, multiply, and have
dominion.
So Noah, he takes this opportunity and he says, thank you, God, for my second chance. And I thank you so much for giving us another opportunity to get it right. And Noah decides to get to work. Noah decides to get to work. He becomes a man of the field and plants a vineyard. Do me a favor and allow me to eisegete this text for just a moment. This is for my aspiring entrepreneur. See, I don't believe that God tells us everything in terms of our purpose, in terms of our destiny. I'm reminded of the story of Abraham, where God told Abraham, get up, leave from where you are, go to a land that I'm going to show you. He didn't say where I'm going to take you. He just says, get up and go. And that's what I'm asking for some of you to do today. I'm asking you to stop asking God to tell you each and everything to do and just get up and go. He already gave you dominion at the foundation of the world. He gave you dominion again at the second chance with Noah. Go be fruitful, multiply, and have dominion. If you see a need, if you see a problem, do me a favor. Use your gifts, your skills, your talents, and your ability, your passion to go and solve that problem. Because if you solve a problem, you'll never go hungry again. Right? So many people are saying, I'm just going to sit back. I'm going to chill. I'm just going to wait on God to tell me what to do. No, it says the steps of a good person are ordered by the Lord, which tells me God will work it out as you walk it out. Stop being lazy in this season and get your behind up and get to work. Get your hands dirty. Plant a vineyard. Do something. I love hip hop. Songwriter says, you got to get up, get out, and get something. Don't let the days of your life pass by. Do me a favor. God has gifted you. God has chosen you. He's given you another chance for you to be fruitful, for you to multiply, for you to dominate. Stop being dominated by your situation and go and have dominion. He's given you the whole world. Go be successful and stop being lazy. So Noah looked around. He saw a need and he began to work it. He planted a vineyard. Here's what's interesting about this. The Bible says that the ark came to rest on the mountains of Ararat. Okay. Which means the ark came to rest on the top of a mountain. But in order for Noah to plant the vineyard, he had to climb down the mountain. So many of us are looking for mountaintop experiences, but the true blessing is actually down the mountain. The true blessing is actually in the valley. People want to look up. Did you know that being on top of a mountain is cool and you can see the whole city? Here in Atlanta, we have Stone Mountain of Georgia. I love going up Stone Mountain. Yeah, you got to go up this thing called Jesus Hill. They have a rail that helps people, you know, get up there. But once you get up, it's a beautiful view. Did you notice that trees don't grow on the top of mountains? Yeah. They say that because it is so high up, trees and vegetation can't grow. So in order for Noah to have planted the vineyard, he had to have climbed down. Stop looking for these high mountaintop experiences and stop being lazy. Get your behind up and go to work. Climb down the mountain because there's just as much victory in the valley as there is on the mountaintop. Climb the mountain so you can get a better view of what you need to come back down to and dominate. Too many people want the mountaintop, but they refuse to experience the victory that exists in the valley. Too many people want the glory, but they don't want to go through the story. So Noah gets to work. But then the reality of the situation sets in after he gets to work. Noah plants a vineyard, but then he got drunk off the wine. In other words, he got high off his own supply. Maybe Noah got drunk to drown out the experiences from the flood. So you remember that there were people who helped him build the ark that didn't make it onto the ark. Some of his friends, closest friends and loved ones passed away because they refused to get on the ark. We've just come out of this situation called COVID. We're still kind of in it, but people are getting vaccinated. And, you know, the president of the United States has moved up his timeline, to allow the vaccine to go and whatnot. And we're starting to get better. We're starting to see the light at the end of the tunnel. But let's not mistake or forget the fact that we've lost over 500,000 people to this dreaded disease. 500,000 mothers, fathers, sons and daughters, aunts, uncles, cousins, friends, grandparents, loved ones that we should be celebrating with right now, but that we now have to memorialize. So Noah plants a vineyard and gets drunk. Maybe he pour one out for the homies. Maybe he was traumatized because after he got out of the boat, maybe he saw the remains of all of the dead flesh. Remember when I preached about Noah last time, the raven didn't come back to the boat because the raven was able to eat on the dead things of the world. And maybe there were some remains of animals and remains of friends that were no longer recognizable, but the stench of the dead things paled in comparison to the stench of the animals and the feces that were on the boat. And Noah said, I got to drown out this trauma and I got to get drunk. Maybe you lost your job and you're trying to drown out the pain of no longer being able to provide for your family. Maybe your marriage is struggling. You're tired of your husband. You're tired of your wife. And you say, in order for me to get some healing, I got to turn to the bottle. Maybe your loved one passed away. You are one of the unfortunate individuals who have had to bury a loved one. I just had to bury a friend of mine, Brian Thomas. Rest well, Bruce. And these last 2 weeks have literally hurt like hell. People think because you're a preacher, you got to have all your stuff together. People think that because you're a Christian, it makes you immune to the pain of life. Oh, let's just smile a while and give my face a rest. Can I tell you, depression is real? We just lost one of the greatest rappers of all time in DMX. Went to jail at 7 years old, 7 to 14. 14, he comes out of jail and he's around some people, grown men that should have been there to protect him and show him how to be a man. And instead of them showing him how to be a man, they give him a blunt, not just any blunt with regular weed, a blunt laced with cocaine. And he said, that's when the beast was born. 14 years old, and up to the point of his death just yesterday, has struggled with addiction. That's a sad story. Make anybody want to drink. Maybe you got cabin fever. And you feel like you're being kept in, you're bottled up. I grew up in a West Indian Christian home. You don't get much more shelter than that. So by the time you get to your freshman year of college and you're away from your parents and you're away from the do's and don'ts and thou shalt not, you go buck wild. You hit every party on campus and off campus. Maybe you're drinking because, watch this, I'm going to step on somebody's toes right now. Maybe you're drinking because you're a millennial and here it is, you can run a Fortune 500, Fortune 100 company. You can run your family. You got 2.5 kids. You got a $350,000 mortgage that you got to pay for. But as soon as you step into the church, they won't let you lead. So it's driving you to drink because they don't value you here. They say you're still the leader of tomorrow. How are you the leader of tomorrow when you're 38 years old? And it drives you to drink. Church folks will drive you to drink. The technical difficulties we had here at the church today drive somebody to drink. Maybe you're drinking because you're trying to drown out your past mistakes. Or maybe Noah got drunk because he and his sons, they had the responsibility of literally repopulating an entire planet. Has the weight of the world been on your shoulders? Like if you don't make it out, your family doesn't make it out, right? That everybody's relying on you to make it. And if you don't make it, like you started off, right? Watch this. Noah got the command to be fruitful, multiply, and have dominion. He got the promise saying, I'm never going to flood the earth again. it. He started off good, right? He said, I'm going to plant the vineyard. I'm going to get to work, right? You ever get that business idea and you going off of sheer energy, right? And adrenaline, and you're good, but then it ain't moving as fast as you want it to hit. The reality of your situation sets in and you're like, I know I got the $1 million idea, but I ain't made a million yet. And the mortgage is due today. And your wife is looking at you like, if you don't produce something, I don't care what you got planted in the backyard. What are we going to eat today? Because you can't sow and reap in the same season. And now the pressures of life are weighing you down. And you're saying, all I got is some liquor. Or eating. Or shopping. Or gambling. Or drugs. Or isolation. I can't turn to anyone else because Noah got drunk. Where was his wife when he got drunk? Where was the accountability partners? Where was the people to tell him, keep going? We support you. We believe in you. It was his own family that was around at the time, but his family wasn't enough. And there was nobody to stop him from getting drunk. How many of you know that one bad decision can have devastating effects? Noah got drunk, y'all. Here's what's crazy about this. I hope y'all are tracking with me. Here's what's crazy about this. The Bible says that as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it also be in the coming of the Son of Man. People were marrying. They were drinking. They were partying. They were tearing the club up, meaning people were getting drunk around Noah's day as well. Here's what's crazy. Read your Bible. Noah was able to stay sober for more than 600 years. Everybody else wilding out around him. And Noah was able to maintain his relationship with God. But when stuff hit the fan, Noah was like, "They did. I'm doing it too, bumping. I'm getting drunk. Because ain't nobody here. I'm tripping. I've been quarantined for so long. Now I'm free. I'm going to every party, every club. Atlanta's tripping because Atlanta been open. But the point is, right, you're now coming out of this quarantine and you're saying, I am going buck wild because of everything I've been through. Noah had a 600-year relationship with God, but he still sinned. Here's what that tells me, though. Past godliness doesn't equate to future godliness. Huh. You see them old saints in the church? Oh, I've been in the church 20, 30, 40, 50 years. You holier than thou. Oh, how you doing? Blessed and highly favored. They quit to judge you for all the mistakes you're making, forgetting that just because they gave their life to Christ all them years ago don't mean they still saved. Once saved, always saved. There's kind of some theology to that, but not really. Because watch this. Just because you gave your life to 13 and now you're 70, it's a lot of life that didn't happen from 13 to 70. And while you can't work your way into the kingdom, it is possible to work your way out. Because just because you said yes to Jesus at 13 don't mean you said yes to him at 35. And now you're 60, now you're 65, now you're 70. A lot of life has happened in between there. You got to say yes to Jesus every single day if you really want to win at this thing called life. You know, cancel culture, people want to cancel you because you messed up. Noah, he had a relationship with God. Noah was in the church. He was in the church. He was praying. He was fasting. He went to prayer meeting. He went to Sabbath or Sunday school, right? He went to all of the worship experiences that the church offered. He did the church, the socials. He went out and he fed the hungry. He did all that stuff right, but yet he still found his way to a bottle. Can I suggest to you that sometimes the church can't get you out of things? I don't have too much time because we started our worship experience late. But let me tell you, sometimes it ain't the building that's going to help you out. It's the other people that you need to connect with. I'm going to explain that in just a minute. Hang tight. Sit with me before you go off. I'm about to be done. People want to cancel you because you were in the church and they want to judge you because you came into the church one day and you were smelling like a little liquor. They smelled a little vodka, or maybe not vodka, because they say you drink vodka and that's not on your breath, but you had some tequila, you had some whiskey, you had some wine, and they smelled it on you. They see you messed up because while on the surface you were looking good, you were dressed your best on the surface,
You came in with a smile and you had all the right jargon. You had all the right lingo and people looked at you and they were like, yo, you looking good. I wish I had the family you had. I wish I drove the car that you had. I wish I lived where you live. But they don't know deep down inside you going through hell. You struggling. And as soon as they get wind that you're struggling, now all of a sudden they want to judge you. They want to cancel you because you don't look like them anymore. You don't smell like them anymore. Now all of a sudden they want to say, how dare you smoke? How dare you drink? How dare you cuss? How dare you do this? How dare you do that? Forgetting that they too are sinners because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Now you want to cancel the pastor who messed around and he didn't intend to sleep around and cheat on his wife or cheat on her husband. But they got to a point where stuff hit the fan and they didn't know how to cope with the situation. And they turned to sin. They did. They turned to sin. I'm not excusing it, but life happened and they didn't know how to cope and they messed up. And instead of you loving them, instead of you embracing them, instead of you praying for them, now you want to judge them and act like you're holier than thou. You want to judge Noah because he got drunk. That's why I called this sermon the other side of the story, because everybody want to talk about, oh, Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. But Noah got sloppy drunk to the point where my man got naked. And my man was walking around the tent like what? Just naked. Hot desert, I can just close off. Filthy, sloppy drunk. Now I just had a little taste of wine. And church folks want to judge them for it. So much that preachers don't even want to preach about it because they don't want to talk about the mess that exists in our lives. Cancel culture, you messed up. So funny how they want to cancel you when you mess up, but when they mess up, they want grace. Abraham, talk about church folks and how they mess up. Abraham was a liar and a pimp. Abraham straight pimped his wife out. Can you imagine? Oh, you don't want to talk about it. Be real. Abraham said, hey, you so fine. When we get to this next town, he ain't doing once. He did it twice. When we get to this next town, do me a favor. Hey, check it out. You so fine, they gonna kill me. So I wanna keep my life. You go ahead and sleep with them, do what you gotta do just as long as I live. Can you do that for me? Can you tell them you my sister instead of my girl? Pimped his wife out. Yet he still became the father of a great nation. David, an adulterer, a census taking, disobedient, adulterous murderer. Killed Uriah, put my man on the front line. No, he didn't cast the bow himself, but he put him in the heat, in the thick of the battle, because he knew he was going to die. Here's how crazy he was. David was so deceitful that he brought Uriah home. He was like, hey, go sleep with your girl. He was like, no, I'm good. He was like, dang, that didn't work. Now what I got to do? All right, well, you're not going to have sex with her. I guess you got to die. Yet he was still a man after God's own heart. Samson liked to drink. He was a Nazarene. He wasn't even supposed to drink. He liked to drink. He liked to touch dead things. Played with women. Yet if you read the Hall of Fame of Faith, his name is still there. And I bet you he's still saved. Hebrews 11. What about your story? All of us are guilty of something. That's the reality. All of us are guilty of something. You ain't got all of your stuff together. You are toe up from the floor up, messed up from the neck up. And reality is you look like this. You may come to church and you got your nice suit and tie on. People telling you, oh, you look good today. I had somebody tell me, oh, Pastor Darrell, you losing weight. You look good. I didn't know I had to dress up for church today. But in reality, I look like this. I smell like food and oil and urine. I got lipstick on my shoulder and on my neck. And well, maybe you feel like Whitney Houston in the movie Waiting to Exhale, where she says, I know I shouldn't be doing this, but my body needs this. Yeah. Take off your mask. And acknowledge that you look like this. I smell like food and paint and garbage. I'm stained. I am tore up from the floor up. And guess what? Even in my condition, my God still loves me. Paul says, when I want to do good, I do bad. When I want to do bad, I do good. Oh, wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from the body of this death? He says, watch this. Thanks be to God who's given me the ability to triumph. Even in my weakness, he is made strong. So watch this. I'm going to boast all the more in my weaknesses. I'm going to boast all the more in the fact that I drink and I cuss and I smoke and I lust and I'm addicted to pornography and I shop and I gamble and I don't return my tithe and I do all the things people say is so wrong. I boast in my weakness because in my weakness, he is made strong. It's when I'm broken that he can pick me up and put me back together. That's Paul. That's your Bible. Your Bible says that. So why are you trying to cancel me because I got real life going on? When Jesus says, I ain't canceling you, I still love you because I still see behind your, I see behind your mask and I see the reason why you're struggling. And my grace is sufficient for you. Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane. And he prays three times, Lord, take this cup from me. Now, not my will, but your will be done, but take this away from me, Paul. Three times. Paul says, there's a thorn in my flesh. You got to take it from me, Lord. And God is like, no, I'm good. My grace is sufficient. It's sufficient. My grace is sufficient. I'm going to say it one more time. My grace, God's grace is sufficient. Is there anybody that's excited about God's grace? Can you just type grace in the chat? What grace will do for you is let you come to the reality that no matter how fancy your suit is, how much of an education you have, and how long you've been with the Lord, walking with the Lord, 600 years like Noah, at any given time, you could slip. DMX says, I'm slipping. I'm falling. I can't get up. Got to get back on my feet so I could tear stuff up and be who God has called me to be. Unfortunately, DMX, he died of an overdose. The overdose triggered a heart attack. And because of that heart attack, he went without brain function for about 30 minutes and on life support for a week until they finally pulled the plug on him. He struggled with his demons, but even in the middle of his struggle, my friend Brian Thomas, he has a saying. He says, life for me is a beautiful struggle. Because God loves me at my worst, he loves me at my best. I'm trying to always stay in the best. But even when I don't stay in the best and I slip into my worst, he's still there for me. He's still rocking with me. He still loves me. Let me end it here. Watch this. Ham's sin was that he saw his father and he laughed and he went to gossip and he went and told his brothers, y'all see daddy. Daddy is in the tent, sloppy drunk right now, and my man's naked. Y'all gotta come see this. And certain people around you right now, they want to laugh because you're addicted to drugs and alcohol. You're a cheater, an adulterer, a gambler, a drunk. You're addicted to food. You're addicted to drugs. You're addicted to porn. You're addicted to sex. You're just addicted to stuff, and they want to laugh at you. But what Noah's sons did, the other brothers, instead of laughing and commenting, in the middle of his mess, they walked backwards. They didn't see his father's nakedness. And they came and covered their father. God wants me to tell you that in this season, God is going to send the right people along your way that are going to cover you instead of comment, that are going to cover you instead of tweet about you, that are going to cover you instead of gossiping about you, that are going to come and cover you, that are going to come and pray with you, that are going to come and be compassionate and merciful and say, Darrell, I know you've messed up, but we still love you. And they're going to come and cover you. Now, here's the thing. Here's the thing. Here's the thing. If you're anything like me, I'm now covered in Christ's righteousness, but But at the same time, I don't want to be covered. I want to be changed because I still stink. You don't know the, you don't know what I had to go through to get this dirt on me. I thought I could just rub it around in the dirt for a little bit and be all right, but that didn't do it. It took me probably a good hour and a half to get the shirt dirty. One thing I noticed was the more I started messing around in dirt and stuff, the more comfortable I got in my dirt and in my stuff. And because I've been through so much, I want God to just change me. I don't want to be covered. I want you to take this off. I want you to take this off, God. I'm holy, not holy, but I'm holy in a bad way. I got the holes and the wounds and the scars of my mess still on me, and all you're gonna do is cover me. He says, yeah, my robe of righteousness is enough. Why? Because I don't want you to take off what you've been through, and it's becoming a part of you. Why? Because we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. And the reason why God doesn't take off what we've been through is because we have to help somebody else know that if God covered me, he can cover you too. I don't want this. I want this off of me. I still smell the stench of my past. And God says, you're good. My grace is sufficient. Just put my cloak on you. You're good. And so now what I'm learning to do, even as your pastor, and I'm done, I'm learning how to forgive myself. Because God has already forgiven me. So now it's a matter of me saying, I am forgiven. I am still called. I am still chosen. I am still blessed. I am still loved. And there's somebody watching me right now. I need you to do two things for me. The first thing I need you to do is I need you to accept God's covering. If you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, now is your opportunity. Today is today, the day. Now is your moment to just say, you know what, God, even in the middle of my mess, my situation, my circumstance, I just put the bottle down. I just put the blunt down. I just left old girl's house. I just did what I wasn't supposed to do. God says it's okay. He says, come. Come. Story of the prodigal son. The father was standing on the porch, looked for his son every day. And then one day he saw a familiar figure coming down the driveway. And instead of waiting for the son to reach the porch, the father ran to his son, put a robe on him, put a ring on his finger, and said, welcome home. I need you to do me a favor. I need you to start taking the steps down the driveway. And God is going to run to you, and he's going to cover you and say, welcome home. But you got to start it today. Do me a favor. We're in a virtual space, but you can still virtually come. I want you to text the word decision. Take your smart device right now, and I want you to text the word decision to this phone number, 619-332-2887. The contact information, right? The number is 619-332-2887. In the message, like you're sending a text message to somebody, just type the word decision. We want to do life with you. Just like Jesus, I'm telling you right now, you have a pastoral staff here, Dr. Ross and myself. You got leaders here at this church. We're not going to judge you. If they judge you, come tell me about it. I'll tell them about themselves. You got to start the process. You got to start the journey of coming back home. We're going to come meet you halfway. And just like Jesus is saying, welcome home. We're going to welcome you into this church as well. Because watch this, you can't do life by yourself. Noah tried to do life by himself. He had his wife there, but he couldn't turn to her. He had his kids there, but they were grown, living their own lives. They got their own wives. They got their own family. So we turn to the bottle. Before you turn to that thing again, I want you to come to us. And we're going to help you do life. And even if you do mess up, while we're your accountability partners, while we're doing life together, we ain't going to turn our back on you. Text that word decision to 619-DECATUR. Here's the second thing I need you to do. I'm going to let you go. Now that you've been forgiven, God, listen. God has not given up on you. I need you to forgive yourself. I need you to say, you know what? I messed up, but my condition is not my conclusion. Where I am now is not where I will stay. I forgive myself for drinking and for smoking and for the addictions. Lord, if there's grace, give me that grace so I can go be who you want me to be. And that's it. Do me a favor, say a prayer with me. Lord, forgive me for my sins. Give me the grace to keep living for you. In Jesus' name, amen. If you said that prayer, you just got saved. Welcome to the family of God. I love you with the love of Jesus Christ. Always remember, you are called to something greater. In spite of your mistakes, in spite of your setbacks, you will be great because there's a great God living inside of you. Make sure you worship with us this coming Wednesday as we go into a new series called Signs, how to identify the signs in our lives and identify how God is speaking to us. I love you. I see you next week.